You heard it from Eric. This is the third time that we have done this. And for me, with great pleasure, the person I introduced today, I think, has been a very special manager of resource in our industry and has presided over some very special years. I'll just give you a very brief rundown on Bob Massey. Trained as a businessman with an MBA and a lawyer at Columbia, going to McKinsey, and then an apprenticeship, if one likes, in the information marketplace at Torstar, the Toronto Star, and then when I first knew him at Gale in the educational side of Thomson Corporation. He came to Chemical Abstracts in 1992. It's 18 years ago. So his tenure there has taken him through the critical years, the years that we've many of us in this room have experienced of the build-up of the information marketplace pressures, of digitalization, the intensity around change. Those who know him regard him as the ultimate professional. So, Bob, it's a great pleasure to welcome you here today. You come. I think as our first representative of a professional scholarly society at this table, Der Hank of Springer last year, of course, represented big science of a different sort, and before that, Harold Varmus represented. Harold Varmus, I guess. certainly made the argument for PLOS. Now, let's come to some questions. I'd like to start, if I may, with that astonishing period of growth, chemistry in the internet age. And I'd like to begin by asking you about how you see that in terms of the information overload. And I haven't heard much of this yet today, but it does seem to me that that is one of the greatest problems of our time.
Well, David, thank you first for inviting me here. Thank you to STM Group as well. Those of us like yourself who've been around the industry for a while know that information overload is not a new term. And all of the abstracting and indexing services, all the secondary services, were founded on the premise that there's too much information to be accessed, so some kind of filtering is needed. There has been, however, in chemistry, which my physics friends and others will indulge me if I say is the central science, there has been an acceleration of growth in the chemistry arena, and that's been captured in our registry, et cetera. So, 2 points. I don't think the burden of accessing information is a new phenomenon, but in chemistry, there is a speed up in production of chemical information.
So, when you arrived in 1992, how did chemists typically tackle the problem of sourcing information?
Yeah, that's kind of my favorite story. Many of you know maybe Rudy Potenzone, who was our vice president of new product development at the time. There's a saying in chemistry, and if you run into any chemist over 45 or 50 years old, that person will tell you that it was routine, it was ritual to spend 2 weeks in the library before you began any project. And for the most part, the 2 weeks was spent alternating between the big red CAS books on the shelf and then the shelves that contained your journals. and this walking back and forth and taking notes and developing the mental landscape and the bibliography of this particular research project. So I would say that right through the 1990s, that 2 weeks in the library was characteristic. And what we confronted was how to, in many ways, revolutionize that. The other thing I would say, maybe orthogonal to that point, is the other characteristic, which we may come back to and talk about later, which is Asia, is that we had, what I like to say at the time, is we had a $20 million business in Asia, except it was owned by other people because we only sold two or three copies of CA at the time. But there was a huge business in China and in the region in our print book. So those are some of the things we saw in the early 90s. Mm.
And just bring us then up to date. How long would you expect, and by what process would you expect discovery to take place today?
Well, our print is gone for us. We've completely made the transition. Last year was the last year in publishing of the Print CA, the iconic red volumes. So we're all electronic. We have two electronic services. One is the Information Professional Service, STN, which in partnership with FitzCarlsruhe. The other is our individual chemist or researcher product called SciFinder. And I would say that the 2 weeks that the chemists used to spend in the library has been reduced to anywhere from 10 minutes to an hour and a half, depending on the scope of the research. And if I may say so, and if you think about it, this is a case where the aggregate productivity of an entire discipline has been multiplied in untold ways. If you just add up that time around the world, and I think most chemists would agree to that point. What's been done with that shrunk time is another issue, and I think there are questions, particularly in drug discovery, as to why we're not as productive as we might be. But from our perspective, I think it's been a pretty consequential improvement.
Just pursue that one a second, would you, Bob? You know, it does seem to me anomalous that big pharma should be less productive with more productivity tools.
Well, I'm not an expert on this, and there are probably others in the room who know more about it or struggled with it a little bit. I would want to reference Dr. Matt Toussaint, who is the head of our editorial operations, a PhD chemist, and has a lot of expertise in this area. But one of the things we're seeing absolutely is that the pharmaceutical industry is restructuring itself. It's in a state of turmoil. And of course, as you know, that derives in large measure from the failure of the drug pipelines to produce the next generation of patentable medicines and pharmacologically active molecules. So why this is happening, I don't know, whether it's structural, whether it's one of these sequential things in which some of the scaffolds have produced all they're going to produce. I don't really know.
But that may, under the influence of searching very large related databases in human genomics, that may restart, I guess, in some way or another.
Well, I think it raises the ultimate question of whether innovation in drug discovery is driven by the access to information. If that were the case, then you would presume we'd have much more innovation, or whether it's driven by something else.
Okay. I'm going then to steer us in a slightly different direction. It does seem to me that Chemical Abstracts has three client types. The industrial chemists, we've spoken a little bit about them, and the researchers, and we've spoken a little bit about them, and of course the intermediaries, librarians, the information managers. What about the balance of these groups? Can you serve the same needs across those groups? Mm-hmm. How has that developed in your time?
Well, I've been thinking about this conversation and the audience and what really is going to interest the audience. And I'd have to say that there's a lot about chemistry that's somewhat unique, and it relates to the user groups you're talking about, but it also relates to the source of information. So first of all, chemistry is a science, as you know, that has its own industry. It's called the chemical industry. We have the pharmaceutical industry. You have biotech, a bioscience industry. We serve academia. And then we serve the entire intellectual property range. And I think it's worth digressing to say that there's so much chemistry and patent information that that's something that differentiates our discipline from some of the other disciplines perhaps in the room. So when you say how do we serve them, I think there's a unitary aspect to chemistry. It's all united under molecular collections. We serve anyone who's interested in science around molecules. So the challenge is not in building the information, but in delivering it. And we deliver it in different ways. And I would just to be focused, I would say we divide the world sort of into two massive disciplines. One is intellectual property, and there we serve information professionals and patent examiners, mostly through our STN service. And that's a service that aggregates many databases along with ours. Then we serve the individual researcher with our SciFinder product, and then you differentiate down from there. But I think that you've put your hands on a couple things. One is how many disciplines chemistry touches. We take information from multiple sources, and we access information from thousands of journals across many disciplines. It's all unified by the molecule.
Right. And in terms of the molecule, it's the registry environment which gives you the referencing which keeps that clean and neat for a whole industry.
Right.
So tell me a little bit about how the registry function works.
Well, the registry is you might call it sort of the phone book. The registry is the listing of chemical substances. We have the structures, names, common names. We give a registry number for every curated substance. We have property data. We have 1.6 or so billion data points around all these substances. The registry is controlled, and I think as I look at the topics discussed today and the issues facing everyone in the audience, we're all trying to figure out how the social networks, the communitarian activities, the viral activities of the web, how does that influence our business? And I would jump ahead and say, when you look at something like the registry, we purposefully keep it closed and controlled and quality controlled for exactly the needs of our users. And so we are watching this phenomenon of communitarian and network creation of information. And we resist it because we want people to turn to the registry and know that it's expertly curated, if that makes sense.
Yes.
So I put the registry in the context of today's conversation, and I would say it's if the social trends on the web are over here, the registry is right on the other side, if that makes sense.
Well, yes, but I think it's a vitally interesting topic in many ways because I think very many of us in this room would acknowledge the requirement for centrality, for discipline, for control, for metadata creation in a uniform manner. And you must be one of the world's great metadata providers. And your metadata runs very far through the networks of your industry and related ones. So all of that has to be right, and it has to be authoritative. And yet we've heard today we're living in a world. Well, here we had the Guardian standing where we are, talking about opening the APIs, bringing in the users as collaborators. Ironically, he was saying that in the context where his business was getting smaller as he was doing it. And I don't suppose your business is getting smaller, but reflect on that. You are, by necessity, a sole provider of that content.
I'll tell you two things about our business that might be amusing. One is that well before the internet and this idea of community creation of information, Our databases were actually created by volunteers around the world. So he had streams of chemists sending information to Columbus, Ohio, to build the database. So the communitarian impulse was there, but first of all, there was time to do it and time to edit it and time to curate it. And there were no systems. It was all kind of done by mail. So we were communitarian before communitarian was enabled by the internet. The other thing is we did build the STN system, which was pre-internet. It was disparate databases in disparate locations, all mediated by the same software regime, if you will. Mm. So we kind of beat the internet in two ways. But coming back to your point about the registry and about curation, let me give you one simple example. You take a news story and you could say there's no definitive news story. Our speaker pointed out that you could have 1,500 news stories on the Ryder Cup and you can choose among them. But getting a molecule exactly right is vital for a lot of reasons, and you know the concept of chirality, that my hands look the same, but they're not really the same because they're oriented in different ways. You can have the same molecule that's chirally different, and one will cure and one will kill. And you absolutely have to get that right. So being okay in chemistry is not a concept people accept, and being sort of the right substance is not acceptable. And that's what's driven us to this idea of quality and curation. And this is why some of the powerful ideas of the web are a little difficult to translate into our corner of the science, if that makes sense.
Yeah, but you made the point at the beginning of that answer that you were, even in the pre-internet days, you were working with a community of members to provide user-generated content, as we would say in the jargon of today. Is that still the case? Do you still?
We work with a wide community all around the world of editors and scientists. The difference is they work under a controlled system to ensure quality and to ensure the indexing, et cetera, is uniform, if that makes sense.
Yeah, yes, indeed. Yes, it certainly does. But because in chemistry that central discipline must be maintained, is that a role which can only be done by a professional body, by a scholarly society? Is that something which means that other publishers and indeed commercial publishers in the chemistry sector have to take different roles adjacent to that?
No, I personally, I'm a believer that you go back to basic functions and don't focus on the modalities. In other words, we know what we need. A scientist needs the most accurate, comprehensive, and accessible source of molecular information. How that gets built over time can change. In our case, it's changed. And I don't think there's any priority to a tax-exempt organization or a commercial publisher. It's conceivable in 5, 10, or 20 years that there will be a web community modality that gets it done. The only thing I know is in the next planning horizon of 3 to 5 years, it looks like it still needs to be done the way we're doing it.
We said earlier that we're approaching yet another age. You have defined the way in which the chemical abstracts environment saves time and energy and increases productivity. But all around us, it seems to me, a great deal of energy in the information services and solutions community is going towards solutions. I guess SciFinder is a push in that direction. Say a word, if you will, about how you see providing solutions.
Well, as I said, we have two services, and I would like to digress a little bit because I know this is the STM group is heavily journal-oriented. But there's one thing I always communicate about our chemistry and what's happened in the last 20 or 30 years that gives an important perspective, and that is if you think of the new chemical substances that have been discovered in the last decades, if you go back 30 years, 80% of them came from journal literature, and only 20% came from patent literature. In the last 20 years, that's turned on its head, and we find 70 to 80% of new substances are in patent literature. So when you talk about workflows, and part of the key things we do to facilitate the work of researchers is to drive that chemistry out of patents and combine it with the information from the journal literature. This is the one science, I think, that is characterized so profoundly by the link between information that's published in journal literature and information that is, in effect, monetized in the intellectual property regimes of many nations. Something like 35% of all new patents are chemicals, chemical substances. So to come back to your question, our job is to make that is to make that chemistry unified and accessible. If you're interested in a substance, you're not interested only in the substance as it appears in journal literature or in patents. You want to see it across all those resources. I would say that SciFinder itself was really developed by a team that understood the way a chemist thinks.
Yeah.
And the chemist pursues information in a number of what we used to call pathways. And we simply designed SciFinder to mimic those pathways and to lock in on the way the chemist's mind worked and then open up the vista of our information through those pathways. And it's remained the platform of choice now for about 15 years for the individual chemist.
Yeah. Okay. Discovering those pathways in some disciplines seems to me to have been a huge difficulty. You, of course, are a membership organization. So it follows from that, I guess, that your members are going to tell you a lot about those behavioral pathways. But we all know that users don't always tell the truth.
Right.
They often tell you what they would like to be the truth.
Well, first of all, we're an operating division of a membership organization, but the membership and our publishing are completely distinct. We deal with customers around the world, whether they're members or not. Yeah. I think the issue of understanding what your users do is one of the great conundrums. If it were easy, we wouldn't struggle. And you have market research. People tell you what they want to do, and then you find out their buying habits are different, or their buying habits are one thing and their consuming habits are different. Mm-hmm. Then you have in our industry the fact that we have buyers and users. You have gatekeepers. You have all the things that make it complicated. Our strength has been both in our information professional service and in our individual service. We've been very close to the customer. And one of the things that we looked at early was not to let anybody get between us and our user. And I think in all the discussions today about what's happening on the web, I wouldn't say it's a piece of advice, but it's with me. It's almost a basic rule: is if you're not dealing directly with your customer, you're going to have a problem longer term. Mm. And I think we've been very close to the customer, the chemist.
We've been talking through this discussion about information, but if we then follow the line that I've been pursuing about solutions. You're going to be driven in the direction, surely, of building applications, developing software tools, developing analytics. Is that something which you feel is within the competence of the organization that you head, or will you be into acquisition or strategic alliance or commissioning from third parties to develop those attributes?
Well, you and I participated last week in an information industry event, and I think one of the speakers said that in the future, everyone in information will be a technologist. And I think those of us who come out of traditional publishing are seeing the increasing sway of technologists in our business. And we heard a speech from a senior Facebook executive making the points of how technology is overcoming content in many ways. A few words on CAS first. If you go back 30 or 40 years, there were only two or three places in the world where structure searching was being done. Columbus, Ohio was one of them. We invented our first, systems were developed at CAS for CAS because there was nowhere to get an email package. So we have an organization that you, in some ways you have to persuade to look outside because they've done so many things and we've done so many things well. Yeah. But two quick things. One is, as I said, we have a partner, Fitz Karlsruhe, and working on developing new systems for STN. We partner with more than 150 database publishers, and we have many partners in this room. Peter Lowe from InfoChem is here. We work with him. I will be remiss if I fail to name people around the room. We work with dozens of IT suppliers, et cetera. So absolutely you have to partner. Absolutely you have to use best practices. Absolutely you have to reach outside. Brian Crawford, the head of our publications division, we are in constant close contact with them, so to work with the full tech side of things. So I would hope we're able to succeed in the technology era, but I wouldn't want anybody to think we're trying to do it alone in any way.
Mm. So as you remark, we were together in Miami last week in a great tropical storm. One of the tropical storms that I felt was going through the conference that we attended was the move to mobile. Everybody flaunted their iPads as if they couldn't get in and out of the room without one. Are chemists like that? Are we going to see the flight to the iPad?
Every time you hear trends today, I think the three that come to my mind is social, mobile, and Asia. So we may or may not talk about Asia, but what I find most interesting is that in chemistry, both social and mobile feel not as powerful, I'll just make that observation, as I think in other disciplines. But going to mobile, a small plug, CAS was the first organization to transmit molecular structures to mobile devices 5 years ago. It's novel, it's interesting, but the mobile devices are not widely used for research. They are used apparently for updating and reading, a certain level of reading. I would say that Brian Crawford and the ACS Publications Group have a marvelous mobile application, and they're gathering data on how much it's being used on that side of the house. But we're not seeing a lot of the heavy-duty research being done on the smaller mobile screens, but it'll probably come over time.
Mm. That's interesting. Another great theme which seems to me to run through our times is the theme of compliance. Mm. We work in hugely regulated industries which are being re-regulated as we speak. The cost of compliance is rising. And that would be there in chemistry, it would be there in pharma, it would be there in a lot of your clients' thinking. Do you deliberately think about how you can build compliance-related environments?
Do you mean compliance in terms of regulatory compliance?
In terms of regulation best practice, industry, self-regulation as well as government regulation.
When you look across the chemical and related enterprise, there have been dozens of directions we could go in. I hate to give you an answer that sounds less aggressive than it might, but the sheer growth of chemical information and the ability to gather that information, to systematize it, to make it available, particularly with what's happening in patents, have absolutely consumed us and have given a lot of growth. So we're not really involved on the compliance side or the regulatory side, the FDA side, et cetera, et cetera. We stay pretty focused on the R&D, the very early R&D, mm-hmm. and on the intellectual property side because of the importance of patents and chemical information there.
Right, okay. I'm going to draw to an end in a moment and ask if we have some questions.
You don't mean that
from the floor. Well, you could be lucky.
I mean, your health is all right.
No. Could fall off my perch. It wouldn't be the first time. I'm going to draw to a close. Perhaps I should have said. But before I do, let me just ask a question about scholarly societies, because I think, you know, you are the first person who works for, although it is an autonomous division, who works for a major scholarly society. It does seem to me, as a casual observer from outside, that the small players and the niched players in that environment are struggling. Some of them have closed. And the large players are getting larger and more coherent. And yet we keep on reading about cross-disciplinary creation of new niches, creation of new science fields, and the journals publishing and societies associated with them. Could you comment on that apparent conundrum?
Yeah, I warned David several times. This is not a subject I'm any good on.
That's why we're asking. Right.
But I'll just make an observation that the business of societies, to the extent that it is publishing, I think the publishing wing faces the same competitive global technological challenges as anyone else, and is subject to the same need to be a leader, to be a value add, and to compete. On the society side, I'm really not an expert of what societies do or what their value add is. To the extent that it is a convening function, to the extent that it is a social function, you have all the globalization and web activities going on, and you have other alternatives for people to take. So I would suspect that societies and their publishing wings have a dynamic going forward that'll play itself out. We talk a lot about interdisciplinarity. Fortunately, chemistry is at the pivot point of so many sciences that we can bridge. But you probably can find a better spokesman for societies. I'm more on the business side.
Yes, and I'm interested in that interdisciplinary thing because there is chemistry in almost everything.
You can eliminate the almost.
There's chemistry in everything, right. Actually, your scope in distribution and analytics terms is total, complete, across the hard sciences.
Right.
And
so we work with AIP, we work with biological and bioscience journals. We try to drive the chemistry into a common format so that it can be accessible to everyone. And in that sense, we are often at the interdisciplinary nexus of, for example, cancer research or research into new substances, nanotechnology. So we have an opportunity, a blessing really, to be in a position of a science and a publishing discipline and a search and a web discipline that reaches across sciences and allows us to be useful, I think, both to users and to disseminators of information. I sometimes tell people, I have friends in the journal industry, and I'll say, if your organization published an article in 1973 that references a certain chemical substance, it's not likely that can be easily found except through CAS. Mm. And I think that's a hugely useful thing, and it's a hugely, I think, symbiotic thing. That's positive for everybody.
I began this by calling you the ultimate professional. As a manager, 18 years, is it a very, very different sort of ship to manage to the one you came aboard in 1992?
Well, we were half print in 1992. It was pre-internet. I remember sitting in a senior team meeting, and some of you may know a man named Nick Farmer, who was the head of IT at the time. And I distinctly remember Nick saying, I want to add an item to the agenda. And he said, fine. He said, I'd like to talk to you for 5 or 10 minutes about something called the internet that I think is going to be really important. And I remember that moment in the early 90s. And it's changed phenomenally. I won't bore people with all the many ways it's changed. But we haven't talked about Asia.
No.
And I have to tell you that we have any conversation about the next 5 years that doesn't include the word China and Asia is a disservice to what's really happening.
Then let's have that conversation. Where are the drivers?
Well, I think on the journal side, there's you all know better than I do the surge of publishing. I would say from the chemistry side, we put out a press release last year that said that in 2010, for the first time in our history, we have found that China is the number one producer of chemical patent information. They've surged past the US and surged past Japan. If you take the output, if you take the patenting and the innovation side, if you take the manufacturing process side, and then if you add in the statistics of the number of scientists graduating in China, if China and India to some extent, but certainly the area including Korea, et cetera, if they are not the drivers of the next 20 years and there are going to be so many changes, then I'd be extremely surprised. And I'd add one thought to this, but I really want to credit Matt Toussaint for suggesting this idea to me, and that is that if you look at the sweep of the last 200 years and where science is practiced and compare it to where science is published, there has to be a change in where science is published in the next 20 or 30 years because of where it's being practiced. And I think that the shift to Asia is going to touch everyone in this room, including ourselves, and how we cope with Asia and the communitarian and social and networking power of the web. I think those are the two phenomena that will decide whether we're all individually or collectively successful in the next 5 or 10 years. Thank you for letting me talk about Asia.
No, you're more than...
Before you end.
You're more than welcome, Bob. You're more than welcome. Let me then turn it over to... Eric's going to do...
I was just going to point his finger. Great.
All right.
Questions? Oh, come on. Not a single question? I think David might be losing his touch. There we go.
Anthony Watkinson, University College London. This is a very naughty question, but as nobody's asking a question, CAS has a reputation of high cost to the libraries, and they scream a lot, as you know. Any way you can help them?
Help them in their screaming? do you mean what kind of, you mean academic libraries? Yeah. A couple of points. I think that as far as costs go, the point I made about patents is a very important one. We basically price to recoup our costs of globally creating this information. You'll find, for example, that most of the scientific information that you buy in academic libraries does not have rich patent information in it. It's mostly journal information, which is great. But if you want the additional substance information, it's costly to produce. We have the lowest, net contribution margin of any publisher you'll deal with. So, for example, when you pay a dollar to a publisher that will go unnamed, 30% of that money is profit. With us, it's more 7 or 8% that's returned to the society for its functions. So I don't say that defensively. It's just to give you the picture. On the academic side, I'll just tell you quickly, and I'm happy to talk about it. We are increasing the capacity that we provide to universities right now by 20% without a price increase. And we're trying to use improved technology to give improved access. But I also think that sometimes reputations are hard to live down. And I think if you look at it per search and if you look at it for the type of information, probably, and I say this objectively, probably you'll find we're not as expensive as the reputation was in the long distant past.
You're the first person I've heard who's really objective about their own pricing policy. It's it's an art form.
It's all that it's all that crying.
Right.
Takashi Yamagawa, Yusaku Corporation, Tokyo. Hi, Bob.
Uh-huh.
What I'm going to say is not a question, kind of question. I'd like to say, don't forget Japan. And don't forget to play golf with me. Thank you.
Did you forget Japan?
No, I did, you know. Japan has been the number one producer of scientific chemical information for many years, and remains a vital part of the scene. You're right.
Do you still play golf?
That's off the record.
Anyone else? No?
Okay, in that case, I'd like to thank both Bob and David.
Thank you.